And what I mean by an age-defying shoulder is basically that as we get older and there are certain activities that we want to do, is that the shoulder doesn't limit that. So the more active you want to become, the more challenging it can be, but that the shoulder isn't going to be the limiter of your activities, because you're going to see the shoulder can pose some problems as we get older. The shoulder undergoes senescent change, which is simply age-related. It's normal. The most example that everyone understands, gray hair. What does it mean? It means you're not 20 anymore. But the shoulder really will naturally deteriorate as we get older, and that invites vulnerabilities. What happens in the shoulder as we get older, first, bone spurs form. So bone spur, most bones, the edge of the bone is fairly smooth. Then as we get older, a sharp little knife grows out of it. A little sharp edge grows out of it. Now we get bone spurs all over the place. You get them in the neck and your back, and neck and back, when they become troublesome, because they pinch nerves. That's what happens in the neck and the back. In the shoulder, when the spurs become troublesome, is when they pinch tendons and they pinch bursa sacs. So it's not nerve damage, but it's still very painful. Tendons deteriorate and tear, meaning the tendons of the shoulder, especially the top of the shoulder, are a little softer when you're 70 than when you're 35. And you can be perfectly healthy, and that little softness can invite some problems as well. Because the shoulder is unique. The shoulder has two layers of muscles. And there's the outer layer, which you see here. So this would be the front of the body here and the back. The outer layer of muscles are what you can touch and feel. That's why your shoulder moves. You know, the pectoralis muscle, the chest, the deltoid muscle, the trapezius muscle in the back. You know, when you raise your arm in space, those are the muscles that move your shoulder, that power your shoulder, let you do activities. But the shoulder has an inner layer of muscles. That's called the rotator cuff, and that's where all the mischief lies in the shoulder as we get older. So the other muscles don't deteriorate as we get older, but these do. And so here's the shoulder's ball and socket. So here's the ball, the humerus, the socket would be in here. And the rotator cuff is just a series of tendons on the top of the shoulder, each that have muscles attached to them. And so there's four rotator cuff muscles. So we talk about rotator cuff tendons, but remember, tendons connect muscles to bone. So if a tendon isn't functioning well, or if a tendon is torn, then that muscle can't work. So the symptoms tendons do confer when they have problems, one is pain, of course, but the other is weakness. So here's an example of a shoulder, and here's the humeral head and the socket. And so this just sort of shows the bone here. This just sort of is a cartoon of what a little bone spur looks like. It's just like here to be smooth, maybe you're 35, and here you have a little knob on the end of it because you're 65 or 70. And that spur is there. It doesn't have to hurt, but when it pinches bursa sac or start pinching the tendons, if it does, then that causes a problem. So here's this red thing here, that's the bursa sac. Think of a bursa sac as a balloon with no air in it. It's sort of two layers, but it can easily blow up, and then it decompresses, blows up and decompresses. When it's decompressed, it doesn't hurt. And the bursa sac just lets tissues move next to one another without much friction. But when it blows up, then you get bursitis, then you get a lot of pain. And the other thing is on the extreme end of the scale is when these tendons start to tear, and that can cause bursitis. But you're going to see tonight why bursitis is important for you to understand. If you understand how bursitis works and how to treat it, you've probably figured out 80% of it from right there. So what makes the shoulder hurt? It's rather simple, really, because the shoulder, as we get older, develop spurs, develop some weakness, the tendons soften, maybe because you're less active or because you are less active, everyone seems to get so. You're not quite as strong, your muscles are a bit weaker, and that means you have a certain degree of limits, meaning sort of an envelope that as long as you stay within your limits, you're going to be fine. But when you exceed your limits, you hurt, meaning you're trying to do things that your shoulder isn't able to do. The result, you might be able to achieve it, but the result is it's going to hurt. Not the moment. I mean, if you truly injure it, it can hurt right away. But the most common pattern is you've overdone it and you feel fine, you go inside, and maybe that night you go to bed, then the next day it aches. And the next night it's worse. Then the second day it's worse. It's that delayed onset muscle soreness. That means you've just done too much and your shoulder doesn't like it. So what makes your shoulder ache and hurt? It's the bursa, the bursitis. You know, you could have tendon tears, you could have bone spurs, but if your bursa sac is fine, it doesn't bother you. There's plenty of people. Everybody says, oh, I know so-and-so's got a rotator cuff tear and bone spurs, and it never bothers them. Well, for some reason, their bursa sac doesn't get irritated. So this bursa sac surrounds the shoulder. Again, just think of it as a big deflated balloon. The shoulder refers pain. So, you know, when the shoulder hurts, you say, well, my shoulder might hurt here all. But also, people who have shoulder pain or bursitis pain, it hurts down here. It hurts on the side, it can hurt in the front, it can hurt in the back, sometimes it can radiate up, and that's just a function of the nerves, sort of how God made the shoulder. Because there's only three areas of the body that refer pain. So the back, the neck, and the shoulder. So sometimes it can get a little tricky. People come in and say, God, my pain is killing me here. You know, I say, that's the shoulder. No, it's not the shoulder. It's you know. And it can be a little tricky to figure out. You don't do some activity, it doesn't hurt. You do some activity, it hurts. Okay, that's what we're working with tonight. Because if any of you ever get in a pattern of pain, or generally a pattern of pain, which you have pain at night that distorts your sleep, you go to bed, it aches. And it aches enough that you're not sleeping well. Before we talk too much about pain, because what we're talking about tonight, the pain that we can avoid and treat, is pain that occurs when you use the shoulder in a certain way. That's a different category. In my opinion, that's one you should see your doctor for. It means you got a bad enough pain problem that you're not sleeping well. And in most people, especially people, you know, older than 50-ish, you start parking enough poor sleep habits over a period of time. Next thing you know is, God, why is my blood pressure harder to control? Or if you're diabetic, my diabetes has been out of whack. I mean, you cannot let the sleep patterns distort. So again, we're not talking about that tonight. Because the reasonably expectations to have is that, you know, that with proper treatment, you can keep your shoulder relatively pain-free while you continue to be active. And most importantly, you establish that your shoulder isn't the limiter of what you want to do. Many times talking to people, I say, what is it you want to do? Well, I just want to garden, or I want to do things like that. Yeah, it's, you know. Or I want to play golf. That's easy. So, well, I want to play tennis. Okay. Now, tennis is a different discussion because tennis is much more vigorous to the shoulder, which is fine. But if your aim is to play tennis, you're going to need a little bit more care of getting that shoulder better, stronger, more limber, you know, in better shape than golf. Golf isn't quite as challenging to the shoulder. So I can't emphasize enough that healthy bodies have healthy shoulders, because part of it is sort of, you know, as a general program, your shoulders are bothering you, but, you know, you should walk. It's not a matter of just your shoulder alone, like nothing. I mean, nothing in the body operates in isolation of everything else. So in the shoulder, getting your shoulder strong, it is a matter of exercises that are extremely low resistance, high reps. So if any of you are imagining, this is not going to a gym and say, I'm going to do 10 repetitions of some, this is not that. Not if you have a shoulder that you're trying to get the rotator cuff to behave itself and function well. And there's lots of exercises, but the bottom line is, the shoulder exercises, you're talking about, you know, doing 25 reps, 30 repetitions of some incredibly low weight that you may think, you know, 1 pound, oh, this is embarrassing. Go ahead and do it. The other thing is stretching. The shoulder has more motion than any other joint in the body. It is engineered to work with that motion that's present. So as we get older, we all get stiffer. That's just another thing of getting older. It's a normal thing. But stiffness can be reversed, assuming the joint's not arthritic or something like that, but by stretching. And you may find that, you know, if you've seen a physical therapist or you had actually treatment for a painful shoulder condition, and if part of your problem is that the reason your shoulder starts to hurt is that you get stiffness patterns. If that's the diagnosis, then you're on guard that you have to permanently, you're stretching more. You know, why do you have to stretch? Because your shoulder tends to want to get stiff. Some patients, that's just their pattern. That occurs in some comorbid condition, like especially diabetics, you get into that problem, or people with low thyroid conditions can get into that, but especially diabetics, especially insulin-dependent diabetics. So why do medicines help? Because the pain in your shoulder is mediated through an inflammatory cascade, which means it's inflammation. So if you can stop the inflammation, you're gonna stop the pain. So you know you can sort of treat it. So like, why does ibuprofen or Aleve or Advil better than Tylenol? Because they address the inflammation. Tylenol just addresses the pain. Because this is the deal. If you hear my head here and the bone spurs, and so here's the bursal sac, and this is just depicted as angry and red. And that's why it hurts. So you have to make this thing stop being inflamed, and medicines can help. Aleve, Advil, two of the best medicines. Those are the two best medicines, I think. The problem with these medicines is, the problem with all these anti-inflammatory medicines is that you say, I really need a good anti-inflammatory medicine. Yes, you do. These are good. But you up the ante on the efficacy of the anti-inflammatory medicine, that it's stronger, you're gonna get more side effects. That's the problem. Now, if you got a sensitive stomach, it may not handle that. So that's when I'm thinking Mobic, Meloxicam. There's a lot of other drugs that are not quite as strong, but they're tolerated. And at some point in clinical medicine, it's like, well, if I can give you something that's pretty good, that you can tolerate, that's better than nothing. Here are some adjuncts. When that shoulder hurts, there's a few things to do. You know, if you sprain your ankle and your ankle's sore, and if your ankle's puffy and it's just aching, most people intuitively get it. You get off your feet and elevate your foot, and it feels much better. Same deal with the shoulder. But to elevate the shoulder, being the shoulder above the heart, you have to have an upright torso. The other thing is cold to the shoulder. Don't underestimate how well it works. Like a bag of frozen peas works great. It's like a bean bag around the shoulder. When you apply cold to an injured part, nerves that transmit cold sensation are bigger than the nerve that transmit pain sensations. And when both are stimulated, so you got a painful shoulder and you just put an ice bag on it or a bag of frozen peas, the cold wins. The way the brain perceives it is you're gonna say, God, it feels better because it feels cold. The other thing, of course, you come to a clinical office, if it's really bad, a cortisone shot. Now, people talk about cortisone shots all over the human body, and some places work better than others, but probably of the top two or three areas that a cortisone shot's home run material, meaning we can really help, shoulder. So I think keeping active is the key to staying active, is that at some point, when shoulders hurt or your body hurts and aches, and you want to get better, there's a point where you almost have to do it, and then after your shoulder gets accustomed to it, many times it can hurt less. So I think you got to stay active. Here's the sort of things that I look for when I see a patient in the office. It kind of gives you an idea of the things that are triggers, you know, to be seen. You know, things we'll always ask them, you know, what's the pattern of your pain, especially with sleep, acute or chronic, how long have you had it? What's caused the pain? Because, you know, many people have some trauma. I mean, some people don't. And what have you done so far to treat it? The exam, you know, you're looking for range of motion and strength, but also there's some other things, especially nerve problems around the shoulder. We'll look at the shoulder and try to figure out where it hurts and where it's tender. Generally, looking for range of motion and strength, you say, well, what's normal for this patient? What's normal is the opposite shoulder. You know, and we'll grab the arm and try to do some resistive assessment just to see how real strong it is. And physical therapy has an especially valuable role in the shoulder. It's useful. It can not only assist and it's therapeutic that it helps. But if any of you go on to PT, after a while, I mean, it's not rocket science. It's but part of it, you need to learn. How do I stretch? No, you're doing it wrong. Your elbow goes, you know, at some point you sort of understand the nuances of how to do these exercises appropriately, and then you can certainly do them on your own. And, you know, stretching it out and showing patients how to stretch it out, which is a little bit different. And then at some point, you know, you sort of learn how to stretch it. And so some patients, as simple as, you know, every day they'll stretch for 20 seconds in the shower and their shoulders are good. How to strengthen and how to strengthen properly with the proper techniques is very important. For those of you who have access to water, water therapy for the shoulder is awesome. It's just great. Now, it's even more important if you have a real diseased shoulder. So you're not, we're getting a little bit off topic. This is not just sort of the general wear and tear, age-related stuff. That you have a diseased shoulder, you have a rotator cuff tear, you have arthritis, you got a bad shoulder. And you're trying to find a way to exercise it and keep it good enough so you can avoid surgery. And at some point, you know, the shoulder's weak and it hurts. Well, you know, you go in water, and in water, the arm weighs 1/8 of what it does on dry land. So say my arm, you know, I'm a bigger than average, but my arm might weigh, you know, 25 pounds. And so, you know, in the water, you know, my arm might weigh 3 or 4 pounds to my rotator cuff muscles. So you can have a very diseased shoulder, an extraordinarily weak shoulder, but in water, you can actually still exercise. It comes down to, well, what, at some point, when would you want to see a physician, you know, for a shoulder problem? And you've managed it, you've dealt with it, you know, what are the reasons? Well, one reason, the biggest reason, it's not surgery and it's not treatment. It's diagnosis. Because at some point, if you're asking questions about why does my shoulder hurt, what does it mean, and what's it going to be like in the future, that's called prognosis. You want a prognosis? I need a diagnosis. Sometimes that diagnosis involves imaging, especially MRI. Very valuable in the shoulder. Very good stuff in the shoulder. And for we're talking about tonight, like rotator cuff problems and, you know, getting the tears and spurs. And, you know, the reason that people have surgery is we can't make the pain go away with anything else. We've had medicines and treatment and therapy and all sorts of stuff. So usually, you know, my experience, if I can get patients better, and they might be a little bit weaker than they want to be, but their shoulders, that doesn't hurt, and they're sleeping fine, they're, you know, it's like, well, you know, you don't want surgery for that. Surgery is to remedy pain. It's pain relief. It's to seek that when all else hasn't worked. A lot of times I get asked, well, do I have to always get x-rays or primary care doctors talk about that? And really, the shoulder x-rays aren't that critical initially, unless you've hurt it. Some areas of the body get much softer than other areas. So where the bones, that is. Where does the bones get soft? Hip. That's why you fall on your butt when you're 70, and instead of bruising it, you break your hip. So if you fall on an outstretched arm or fall on your shoulder, you're 65, 70, 75, you got some osteoporosis going on, you know your bones are thinned out, you'll most likely break the bone and not tear a tendon. That's how soft the bone gets. That's just how the shoulder's made. The shoulder is very sort of cancellous bone. It's very soft bone. So it comes down to really, as I finish this up, is sort of making good decisions, is that, you know, you stay active, understand how to manage it, and at some point through trial and error, figure out what makes it hurt and just try to be smart about it. You know, it's something like, you know, someone will say, these are more patients that come in the office that, you know, I've always exercised, I've always done 20 push-ups a day, and now their shoulder has spurs and all that, and it hurts. I said, push-ups is a terrible exercise for someone who's got significant bone spurs. It just is. It's too much compression. I said, if I can talk you into a different way to exercise, you may not need any orthopedic care. But if you stay hard-headed enough and you keep doing push-ups every day, you're gonna need surgery because you're gonna tear your shoulder up. What you've chosen to do is more than your shoulder can handle, which means either choose again or moderate your choice or get serious about making your shoulder better. Better means stronger. Better means more limber. Better means better inflammation control. That's what better means. But on average, I'll tell patients that by age of 70, 1 in 4 people have a small tear in their shoulder. 1 in 4. by age of 80, it's probably 3 out of 4. Now, does that mean everyone hurts? Of course not. They don't hurt. So many people have a small tear, degenerative, they got some spurs, their shoulders never bother them. Most things in their shoulder will sort themselves out. You can manage them, you can manipulate them, you can get them better. But surgery is when everything else has been tried. Because in the shoulder, a lot of people can do amazingly well with tendons and damage and a number of things. So it doesn't have to be a perfectly anatomically normal shoulder for patients to do well. It can have a lot of disease in it. But as long as it's kept toned, strong, and limber, stretch it, and you're smart about how you push yourself, most patients should be able to do pretty well with it. Thank you.